Welcome. My name is Allison Dennis. I serve as Executive Director for the Sitka Center for Art and Ecology, and it is a pleasure to welcome you to our first Resident Talk of 2024. Happy New Year, everyone. Sitka is located at Cascade Head on the North Central Oregon coast and resides on the unceded traditional lands of the Indigenous people now represented by the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde and the Confederated Tribes of the Siletz Indians. Shobha Jetmalani's life family from India to Oregon. Shobha's deep interest in art developed in parallel with her academic training at Williams College, where she majored in chemistry and environmental studies. She also studied studio art and art history, which sparked her artistic instincts and which she continued to nourish in parallel with her later work as a dermatologist. Shobha has exhibited work in both solo and group shows. Her work is included in public collections in Multnomah County and the city of Portland's Vanport Building. She has been awarded numerous grants and residencies, and we are thrilled to have her with us at Sitka. So please join me in bridging wherever you are listening from with our space here on the coast. Make some noise and welcome Shobha Jetmalani to the Sitka community.
Thank you very much. And I guess I wanted to start by thanking Sitka for this opportunity. It's just very special and I appreciate it greatly. And also for the Ford Family Foundation for their support. And I'm going to go ahead and start by sharing my screen. This is just a painting that I've done pretty recently. And I just wanted to get started with kind of my philosophy of what I try to do when I paint. I was born in India and I came to the United States when I was 2 years old. And my father had always wanted to go camping and he took us to Diamond Lake, which at that point was very remote, and took us out with all new Coleman supplies from Sears. And he had all the manuals out on the picnic table spread out, and we had a tent, axe, lantern, everything. He didn't know what to do with them all. My mom was in a sari walking around with my two brothers, and a family that was at the campground saw us. So they had three young sons and they came over and they whipped our campsite together in minutes and then taught us how to camp and how to chop wood and how to set up a campsite. They were an old Oregon family and they ended up showing us around Oregon for 20 years and we camped with them on the weekends. And that became a very deep part of me, being out in the woods and enjoying the natural beauty here. We were so different at the time. There were not very many families from India in Oregon and it was such a welcoming place for us. So I really like to kind of mix nature and science together. And I like to paint in both a realistic and an abstract way. So this is one of the paintings I did more recently. And I like to say enough that you know what's there, but I like it to be left unsaid enough so that you can enter the piece. I come from a really culturally mixed background and it's shown me that we all have human layers, and I like to pursue layers within us. And so I put layers in my paintings. And I like to think about and look at people's backgrounds, their professional layers, their human layers, their emotional layers, and use that as a sounding board for my art and to allow people to enter my art through that. So I like to paint in oil paint. This is a work that's done on a traditional Italian gessoed board. So I learned how to do this from an artist in Portland, where we mix the gesso together, put it on the board, and then paint on it. But so I'll go back to talking a little bit about myself. So I came to Oregon. We grew up here and I studied chemistry and environmental science in college and then went on to become a physician. And I became a dermatologist and it suited me because it was such a visual field and did that for 30 years. But I was really missing full-time art and I decided to go back to my art full-time in 2019. And I've been doing that since then. This is another example of a landscape that I did from Neatarts Bay. And I've also done a series a series of these paintings. I like to use layers to show different parts of my interests. And one of the things I do is use saris that are from my, they're kind of vintage saris from my mother. And these have been collaged on this panel. And then I've painted over it in oil and wax markers. Sometimes I feel like beauty has a lot of power. I know that science has a lot of power, but beauty has a lot of power too. And I think it's a very common thing that we experience. And so some of my paintings, I like to look at beauty and express beauty. But some of the paintings, I like to put people in the paintings and see how they're interacting with the beauty in nature. And some people notice the beauty in nature, and some people are in nature and don't notice the beauty in nature. So I find it a really personal statement to look at how we see the world and how we integrate into that. Being a physician, I really saw the power of connection and human connection and healing and well-being. And one thing I really like about art is that I think it becomes a connecting point for people of a lot of different backgrounds. And so I seek that purposefully to find that connection. I think color can bring out emotion and bring that connection as well. And I really love working with color, as you can see in some of these paintings. So I've also enjoyed adding some different aspects to my art, more with the collage and then mixing the figurative with landscape. Mostly you can see I go for the mood. I try to get into the place and try to experience it and see what emotion or what mood I want to express. This is one of my later paintings, and I'm kind of playing with how much can I say with how little. Artists often speak about that, and so that's what this is showing. And then lastly, this was a piece that I did that I feel is almost like a self-portrait, because it kind of shows the landscape, but it also shows people looking beyond the landscape and where they're from and where they're going and where they are in the present moment. So I think that's mostly what I wanted to say. Once again, I appreciate being here, and I'm so glad to have power and 50 degree weather. It's just awesome.
Thank you so much, Shobha. And we're so pleased everyone weathered the weather so well, and that it is thawing out today. Thomas Meinzen is a composer, conservation ecologist, and writer originally from Eugene, Oregon. He received a BA in Environmental Humanities from Whitman College and a Master's in Ecology from Montana State University, focused on bee and butterfly conservation. He's worked across the U.S. and Costa Rica as a bird and pollinator field biologist, and currently supports communications and operations for two nonprofits based in Portland, Oregon. Thomas studied music composition with John David Ernest and Eric Funk, and was awarded the first William Bailey Music Competition Scholarship, as well as the David Campbell Award for Best Senior Recital for his original work, Interweaving Human and Natural Soundscapes with Transcribed Bird Songs and Live Music. So what better place to blend music with the natural world than at the Sitka Center? Please help me welcome Thomas Meinzen to Sitka.
Thank you, Allison. I'm really, really excited and feel very fortunate to be here, and have been super inspired by this space and by the other artists here. And I did want to talk about some of what Allison just mentioned. I've done a lot of work trying to kind of play at that intersection between humans and nature and science and art. And so I'll share little pieces of some of that today. And then if you're interested in hearing more of the little clips or the entire pieces, then I'll share my site where they are as well. All right, so I started off working on recording natural sound, which is where I'm going to begin in this talk today, in Costa Rica, doing some bioacoustics research as a part of an ecology program, actually. And I was working on a research paper on avian vocalization frequencies, so what pitches birds are singing at and how that's related to the structure of the habitat they're in. So for a sort of general sense of this, like birds in forest habitats, like around at Sitka, tend to sing at lower pitches than birds up in open areas because of the way that the sound interacts with the physical structure of the habitat and the landscape. And so this was really fun and interesting work. And in process, I recorded thousands and thousands of bird recordings from hundreds of different species. And I was really inspired by those sounds to incorporate them into music, along with other sounds, human sounds, ambient sounds, you know, waves, wind, all kinds of things around me. And I was interested in trying to make kind of a statement about how we interweave with the rest of the world, the non-human world, and how sort of the separation between humans and nature is a construct that some societies have made, but it's not really the way things are. And I think sound is a really interesting way to challenge that. And thinking about sound is a good opportunity to kind of rethink our relationship with the natural world. So as part of this, I wrote this song called Songs from the World Around Us that incorporated seven different instruments along with a whole track of live played sounds from birds to wind, waves, railroads, whales, the ocean, all kinds of things. This is a little screenshot of all of the different tracks that went into this. And then it was performed in concert, where basically the track was going live with the instruments playing. And this is just a really fun project to work on. And so I'll play just a little tiny snapshot kind of from the very end of the piece. So, one second. That's just a little taste. There are other parts of it that are a lot more chaotic and that incorporate a lot of more different sounds and bird sounds, and also some biomimicry, sort of, where I wrote, actually transcribed the bird sounds to be written for instruments, and then so then they kind of echo and interplay. It's a 13-minute piece, so I can't play it today, but if you're interested in listening, I can put the link for listening later. And I also wanted to talk today a little bit about some later work and more recent last couple years that I've been working on. So after this work, I ended up going and doing my master's on studying bees and butterflies and their conservation out in Montana. And again, I was working on science and gathering data, and have been working on trying to get the message out about that conservation through the science kind of lens, but I also felt like there was so much emotional power in particularly monarchs, which is one of the species I was studying, which are very inspirational with their huge migration and their story. And so I wrote this piece called Danaus, which is the Latin, one part of the Latin name of the monarch butterfly, about the Western monarch and its migration, and it kind of follows the waking of a single butterfly at its winter roost, and then the rousing of kind of the rest of the roost, and then their migration north, and their journey back south, and then the decline that was going on, and all these threats. So it has some very intense parts, but just for a little snapshot, this is the part where sort of the colony, roosting colony, awakens. Including a pair of brothers that are here in Oregon. They are from Corvallis, and we put together a series of music videos, of original music. I don't think I have the bandwidth out here yet to play online videos, but they've recorded out in nature, including and all in Oregon, and their videos have been wonderful. So I'll share just a tiny little piece of one of these pieces of music, and then if you want, you can watch the video later. So here's the words. So that's that. Out here at Sitka, I'm working on some new music, including just finished a new piece written for this same duo that's inspired by a walk I took out on Cascade Head with Shobha a few days ago. And it also will incorporate some of the bird sound. I'm taking some recordings around here, so I'm really excited to be working on that, and I'm also hoping to release a new album of solo piano music, so that's coming. And I think I'm out of time for today, but I really just wanted to express my gratitude for being here, and really excited to hear what the other artists have to share. Thanks.
Thank you, Thomas. That was so wonderful. It gave me goosebumps just when the music started, and then it kind of just stayed with me for your whole presentation. So thank you so much. Christian Orellana Bauer was born in Cuenca, Ecuador, and is a multi and interdisciplinary poet, visual artist, filmmaker, and musician working in a wide variety of mediums. They are interested in many subjects, relationship to culture, ethnocentric versus ethno-relativist viewpoints, pluralism, ecology and climate collapse, the idea of cultural belonging and its relationship to race, melancholy, humor, and the aesthetic experience. Through these themes and others, they explore parallels and intersections with the socio-political frameworks that construct our reality and their impact on the individual. They received a BA from Portland State University, completed the portfolio program in poetry at the Independent Publishing Resource Center, and have shared their work through galleries, events, and publications around Portland and Oregon. So please welcome Christian Orellana Bauer to the Sitka Center.
Thank you, Allison. Really appreciate it. And I'll start too with a thank you to Sitka in general. It's been lovely here, and I'm really looking forward to working over the next few weeks as well. So I'm going to share today a body of work that's still in development that I'm working on here. I started working on it last summer at the Black Hole Press residency put on by Nat Turner in Portland. I want to give a quick thanks to Melanie Stevens, who runs that residency and has been really helpful in making a lot of the work that I'm going to show today. And then I also want to thank the Regional Arts and Culture Council. I recently got a grant to keep working on this, and they do great work to support the community, the creative community in Portland. I'm also going to recommend that people go and support their work too, because I think they're in the process of losing their contract with the city. And so everything's kind of in flux and we're all like, what's going on? So they need a lot of community support if anyone has time to do that. So the work that I'm gonna be sharing today is working, which is what is name in English. And it means, it's by the from the Quechua language, which is from the Incan and Cañari peoples in Ecuador and along the Incan Empire in many countries in South America, which is my heritage. The work was born a little bit out of a desire to reconnect with my indigeneity. I've been kind of moved from it quite a bit through like colonialism and imperialism, and then physically having moved to the United States at a young age. And so the relationship between the space between cultures has all been really interesting to me. And I think for anyone who's part of a global diaspora, but doesn't live in the place where that diaspora originates, can share that experience of kind of being in the middle. And so this was kind of the reconnection to my indigeneity was kind of a next step in that process of forming my identity, which is kind of never ending. And so this personal research was kind of conducted on a few trips back to Cuenca, Ecuador, where I'm originally from. And some of these photos are from those trips. And it sort of sent me down this rabbit hole where I kind of started with realizing this, coming across this alternative view of a relationship to nature. It's very similar to what Thomas was talking about. The first piece that I'm going to share kind of explores it. I'll go through some of these photos. This is a set of ruins that were on the corner of a street in Cuenca. And then this is at a zoo. This is kind of a ripped plant that they actually have a sign right next to it that says, don't rip the plant. So I thought it was kind of interesting, but I'm digressing. So the first piece is titled, or working title is Nukanchis, which is the Quechua word for nosotros or us. And as I was saying, the alternative view that kind of this one is exploring is the idea that humans are a part of nature, that we have a role to play within ecosystems, and we have to give as much as we take, as well as foster the health of those ecosystems. This has come up in lots of different places, so I'm sure people are familiar with this, but for me, I came to it from reconnecting with my indigeneity and whatnot. And so as you can see, this piece kind of plays with that idea by implementing opposites a little bit. So there's a negative image of a depiction of this leaf and then a positive image. And then on the left side, you have the text, which is the botanical name at the top, and then two common names at the bottom, which is in Spanish and English. So this is cedron or lemon verbena, which is native to Cuenca. And then on the right, you have the text that means nosotros or us. So it's really kind of playing around with that idea of what's lost and gained in both of those different worldviews. And I started to find in my research too that a lot of these ideas still exist in various modern theories. So concepts like panpsychism, which is a philosophical idea that everything has a consciousness, or the idea of complex systems theory, which when applied to an ecological model can really show how the strength and interconnectedness of an ecosystem and the biodiversity of that ecosystem can really affect how sustainable and long-lasting it is. And so because of that like rediscovery that I was kind of coming across, I started to question like, well, if these were around for a while and now they're kind of being rediscovered, what happened in this middle gap? And I started going further down the rabbit hole and sort of realized, you know, it's kind of an easy answer. It's the histories of imperialism and colonialism erasing everything over and over again. But I think more so than that, I started to realize that or come across the idea that the erasure of those indigenous practices was a key part in developing the concept of capital and capitalism and now neoliberal capitalism, which we live under. They were like, you know, in order to have the worldview which we have today of seeing nature as a separate thing from us, a natural world and then a human world, as a commodity and a resource, it has to be separated from us. We can't be a part of it. Otherwise, you know, you'd be taking from yourself, which is counterintuitive and doesn't make sense. And so this next piece kind of explores that historical element of erasure, cultural erasure. This is the shape of this print is a chacana, which is a important cultural symbol and possibly religious symbol that was found all along the Incan Empire. Thinkers and scholars today don't really know what it means. They're kind of like still cracking the code, so to speak, quote unquote. But I kind of compiled what I could find from the possible meanings and put them into this print. So this is an inked version of the print, and then I embossed it after the fact. And this is kind of using that same embossing technique that was seen in the last print. And a lot of the potential meanings have a direct relationship to that worldview of being a part of nature and being more holistically involved as opposed to separate from it. So after I embossed it, this is all still in progress. So this is kind of like a demo version, but I'm hoping to put a cross on top of it, which is a reference to, as the history goes, that when the Spaniards arrived in the Incan Empire, they kind of recognized the relationship between the Chacana and the cross, and used it as a method of trying to sell Christianity to the indigenous peoples. So it's sort of like, you can see that in the erasure of those important cultural symbols, or the thievery, I guess, of those important cultural symbols, it takes away that worldview in lots of different ways, alongside lots of violent tactics as well, of course. But this is the one that this explores. And so then the next piece that I want to share is going to be a poem that I'm going to recite, which kind of brings it back for me to the original onus of the fact that I wanted to reconnect at all with my indigenous heritage, and the fact that I was separated at all, I think, is really a symptom of these broader histories. You know, we all born into this world carry those with us, whether we know it or not, whether we like it or not, you know. And so I think for me, I wrote this poem kind of as an outstretched hand and a message, a question, all the above, to past ancestors. I wrote this at the Museo de Pumapungo, which is in Cuenca, Ecuador, when I was on one of the trips. And this is what I was looking at when I wrote it. It's a wonderful museum. It has a sprawling set of ruins in the back that I kind of took a walk through and sat down and recited this out loud after I wrote it a couple of times. And I hope I got what I needed out of it. I don't know. This is all ongoing. So, you know, it's an ongoing process. But I want to apologize before I recite it to anyone who speaks Quechua in the audience, because it's in Quechua. I'm not a native speaker. I cobbled this together. And so I don't even know if it sounds right, but it's more about the intent. And I think that still reflects that erasure, you know, in the first place, that everything is kind of boring. So here you go. I hope you enjoyed it. And thank you for your time. Imatak Suti. Imatak Harawi. Nukamanan yachai. Nukaiku manan yachai. Dispin sayuwai. Dispin sayuwai. What is my name? What is my song? I don't know. We don't know. I'm sorry. I am sorry. Thank you. That's the end of the poem. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Christian. One of my favorite things about these talks is always both the individual presentations, but then also just the magical through lines that start to show up. There's just something so interesting about Thomas's interpretation of bird voices and you giving voice to Anne's lovely way. So thank you both. Erin Shigaki is an artist and community activist and helps run an annual pilgrimage to Minidoka, the American concentration camp where her family was incarcerated. She is active with Tsuru for Solidarity, direct action abolitionist American social justice advocates. She also serves on the board of Look, Listen, and Learn, a public access television show that inspires radical Black joy and advances early learning in young children of color. She holds a Bachelor of Arts from Yale University and is the recipient of grants and commissions from the City of Seattle Office of Arts and Culture, the Wing Luke Museum, Densho Okuda Memorial Washington Civil Liberties Grant, the Warhol Foundation for Visual Arts, and the National Academy of Design's Mural Prize, among others. So wherever you are, please make some joyful noise and welcome Erin Shigaki to Sitka.
Well, hello, everyone. I'm so thrilled to be here. So far, I've really done nothing but rest and read and hide from the weather. And that's been perfect. That's what I needed, I think. I moved back to Duwamish land of Seattle about 8 years ago from the East Coast, where I studied and became a graphic designer. And I moved back to a very specific Japanese American community that had been built there in the redlined area of South Seattle, which is now Chinatown, since the late 1800s. And that's when my great grandparents came. So my family has thrived there. This is a picture of my dad and one of his baseball teammates in that neighborhood. And then me and my sisters also got to thrive there in this community with our cultural and community structures very intact, but I think we really took them for granted because there is this big event that happened in my community that was mentioned in my bio, and that was the World War II unconstitutional mass incarceration of more than 125,000 Japanese Americans along the West Coast. And my family and community went to Minidoka in the high desert of southern Idaho. And you can just see a couple of images here of the inhospitable climate and infrastructure. But I, you know, as much as I want to talk about sort of that erased part of American history and how it ties together with so much of other American history, I also in my work talk about the strength and beauty of my community. And these are a couple of pictures of family members. My dad is that baby. He was born at Minidoka, delivered by a horse veterinarian, and my grandparents on the right matched and married in that camp, and then were able to leave for the Midwest. And, you know, I'm just really grateful for my community that that they, despite not knowing what was going to happen to them, forged on with love and care. And here's a picture of one of the many baseball teams. This is the Block 42 baseball team that my grandfather played on. And I think one of my friends who is a survivor of Minidoka is in the audience, and his dad is definitely pictured in this photograph. And then of course on the right is Obon, which is our Day of the Dead. And I just love that practice continued in these concentration camps when, you know, the supposed reason for our incarceration was who we were, our Japanese-ness. So, you know, as soon as I wandered into a public art boot camp that the Office of Arts and Culture in Seattle put on, I realized that my North Star is to tell the Japanese-American story in memory of my ancestors and in service of the liberation of all people. And so I started out working with images of the incarceration. Some of you might know that Dorothea Lange took a lot of beautiful images in California that I find very moving. And I turned these into large wheat paste murals. I realized that my work was getting noticed when some of my work was whitewashed on the campus of Bellevue College, which is the third largest college in Washington State. And two administrators lost their jobs over this egregious act. And my community has always rallied to have a healing ceremony on that site when I put those words back on the wall. And I enjoy, you know, talking about other parts of the community. This is a group of Asian American with many Japanese American students at the University of Washington at the time that the executive order came down. A couple other murals that I made with historic images. This is honoring University of Washington students who had to leave campus during the mass incarceration. And I'm also interested in cultural reclamation, as I indicated before, picking up parts of Shinto and other Japanese culture that had been taken away from us in that experience, and sort of in the general experience of coming to America and trying to be more American. So I'm just going to glide through some other images of my public art that are using these motifs. There's a photo of my dad and some sculptural work I did honoring the trophy store that my parents had for my whole, my whole childhood and young adulthood, and as well his birth in Minidoka. I've done a bunch of other mural work with different collaborators. And I also really like to, I guess as I sort of moved through telling the Japanese American story in particular, I realized that there's just a lot of solidarity work that can be done and that makes sense with the story. So this is a mural that went up after the uprising, or during the uprising when George Floyd was murdered, to offer a space of healing for the Black community. And, you know, also to point out the parallels, like this mural went up on boarded storefronts in Japantown and Chinatown that had been similarly boarded up in 1942 due to anti-Asian xenophobia. I've done some work showing similarities between Japanese American and Latinx stories, especially as farmers and producers of food and in the resistance movements. And this is a recent piece about reparations and reparations that I think are due to Black Americans. Because Japanese Americans received reparations, and not everyone knows that either. So here's a little close-up of some ceramic work that I've started to do, and this is something that I'm planning to work on while at Sitka. I have my 300 pounds of clay sitting in my house. So, and then the other thing I want to say is that I'm just so grateful to Sitka for having a whole separate category for activists. I think it's called activists and educators now. And I had never seen that, and I'd been having a hard time finding a residency that would take me. And this is the other side of my work. Speaking on behalf of my community for the things that are going on right now in this country that rhyme so strongly with what happened to my community. You know, in the detention and carceral front. And it makes sense, of course, that the piece of organizing work that I do that is closest to my heart is regarding Minidoka. And I go back there, or we went back for the first time after a few years, to host a big pilgrimage with a few hundred folks, survivors and descendants and allies, to educate and to heal, you know, to allow people to try to find a measure of healing from the things that happened there and that continue to run through us. Unfortunately, you know, it seems like just as soon as we decide to claim those sites of shame for ourselves, another battle occurs. And I've spent a lot of the last couple of years working on campaigns to fight off a giant wind farm right on the edges of Minidoka there. And it's really heartbreaking to see our story being put up against the green energy story. I created these posters, and these are two survivors in my community. The Bureau of Land Management, in their, one of their initial reports, called Japanese Americans and Indigenous people tourists in their papers. So, you know, we're trying to push back as we can, but it's a very interesting intersection of a painful type. So, you know, in closing, one of the questions that I frequently ask, or I ask myself and I have shared out, is what kind of ancestors do we want to be? And I feel that that is a big enough question to keep me going for a while. Thanks for your time. And I'm so grateful for this time to rest and gather myself.
Thank you so much, Erin. We talk all the time about how rest and dormancy are part of the creative process, essential parts of the creative. We got one more speaker, a citizen of the Coquille Indian tribe and is of Maluk, Umpqua, and Filipino descent. He grew up in Coos Bay, Oregon, and received a Bachelor of Fine Arts from Oregon State University. For the past 18 years, he managed the Journeys in Creativity Native American Art Program, previously at the Oregon College of Art and Craft, and now at the Longhouse Education and Cultural Center at the Evergreen State College in Olympia, Washington. Shirod is also the co-director of the Changing Currents Youth Tribal Water Summit, that is a residency and virtual program for Native American student leaders. He is also a sculptor, carver, and arts instructor, and we're so pleased to have him here at Sitka. So please join me in welcoming Shirod Younker to the Sitka Center.
So first off, Shirod Younker Sinsanu, Milak Ka'u, Milakaosh, Kokotane. I'm enrolled with the Coquille Indian tribe, which is about 200 miles south of here in Coos Bay, along with my other tribe, Coos, and then also Umpqua is just right over the other, over the hill there. So first off, I just want to say I am very honored to be a part of this cohort here. I've come here through the Indigenous Placekeeping Award, which has been a research project that I've gotten to try to go through museum repositories and online archives to try to gather images and information to try to restore the ancestral aesthetics of Western Oregon and at least have a conversation about it. If we can't find enough, right? How do we restore the environment? I'm just going to start off with what I started doing at school, and that was creating little lino cuts or wood cuts, and then trying to relate to my heritage and understanding the stories, so that I could better understand the values and the traditions of my people, so I can apply them, right? So of course, this is one of my oldest ancestors to the left. We only had an old photo of her, but in more settler attire. So I decided to put her in some traditional attire, what she would have worn, from rain cape to basketry hat and basket. And then Old Man Coyote in the middle. And then one of the oldest stories that we can date to the right, about crow's tears, of the great floods that happened 10,000 plus years ago during the Pleistocene. All right, okay, there we go. And now here's some of the woodworking that I have done to try to help bring back some canoe culture to my tribe. And in the process of that, growing up in Coos Bay, just kind of seeing all this water and not having our canoes or the artifacts that went along with our coastal heritage and ways. So I started looking and trying to recreate things. To the left here, we've got multiple tribal styles from Western Washington, Oregon, and one paddle from Northern California, just to show that the ancestral arts are really ethnic identifiers. So our paddle shapes are different, so we can tell friend from foe, but then they also have purposes. Up to the right, I was invited to do a group show in San Francisco, and I just started to play around with just some different aesthetics on those tribal styles that are from my area. But the wood was so beautiful, I didn't have the heart to paint it. So I just left it unadorned. And then to the bottom right, there are some acorn mush paddles out of maple, also in that show, just to kind of honor that traditional foods heritage and playing around with the aesthetics, but to just remind me where I want to go and what I want to include in my life, and hopefully get back to a less junk food and more food that is medicine to myself and to our people, right? And if you think about it, you know, an oak tree can produce up to 2,000 pounds of acorns. If that's one tree, just think how fat our people used to be and healthy, right? If those are hand in hand, right? And then here's some other work. As you see, I kind of got a shotgun approach to art. I just kind of do a bit of everything. And to the left is a blanket through eighth generation that my friend and I collaborated on, from a sculptural piece inside the Longhouse of Oregon State. We did some laser cut steel basketry panels on each of the pillars in there to represent each of the tribes with basketry patterns that were indicative of their area or very common in their area. But that way it would make the building a metaphorical basket on how your degree is on creating something and to gather things so that you can share, but then all putting them all together and then also adding a 10th basketry design in there to represent all the other tribes that are not recognized, like the 9 recognized tribes of Oregon. But if you stand in the middle of that great hall and you look at any of those basketry designs, if you're from a tribe in Oregon, you'll know where your ancestral land is in the direction of where that basketry patterns are. To the bottom right is another collaboration that I was fortunate enough to do with my daughter to create a blanket for the University of Oregon to help raise money for their Indigenous scholarship program to make sure that Indigenous students hopefully can get their tuition paid for so they can go to school. And I used patterns that were representative of flight patterns of ducks, and also kind of on the background there, like trying to represent the veins in a in feathers, right? And then up to the right is just a basketry design that was collected from a basket from where I grew up in South Slough or Whitlets in Goose Bay or the Charleston area. And I just wanted to have something that was from home and something that my people or anybody can put on to just to remind them of who they are, right? Here's another collaboration with Tony Johnson, a Chinook Indian, but it's for the Nisoma Memorial. They asked us to do a kind of a placard to create a bronze piece, but we said we needed to honor the people that are still in the ground. And so what this is a cedar tree that has been upturned, and we carved some large implements for male and females and embedded them. So it looked like this tree is blown over in a storm and has unearthed these objects. Of course, the orientation is related to the solstice across the water, but we really wanted to honor them. And it's called Wathlitau, which means gifts for the dead. And these are the objects that we leave for the people that pass on in our cemeteries. So kind of representing that. Here's another piece, another collaboration. I love doing collaborations I just love interacting with other artists, from Earl Davis from Tokeland, Tony Johnson from Chinook, Travis Stewart from Grand Ronde, and then of course myself. This is for the Forest Science Complex, but basically it's the oldest story, another flood story, from that area, the Mary's River Kalapuya. And basically we have five in the Arboretum, we have five giant baskets that only portions are shown. And then in Mary's River Kalapuya, we have the words, some of the words and sentences from that story, laser cut on those aluminum pieces, as well as different basketry patterns. And here's a butterfly one, which is nice. I can connect it to Thomas's lecture, and I can be a part of his glory, which is absolutely beautiful, Thomas. And the 10 figures are above also represent the 9 tribes or animals as well. And then, of course, another 10th figure. We're always adding a 10th figure just because we want to represent people that might have not survived those floods. But the idea of them looking out over the Arboretum and seeing these baskets unearthed while the floods are receding. And then they have to figure out how to take their knowledge and go down and put the world back together. And of course, this all happened during COVID. So it was kind of fitting, although very difficult for us. But it's also a metaphor for how education is, where you sequester yourself from your community. You go to the top of the mountain, you vision quest and get your knowledge. And then you're supposed to go back down and share that knowledge within your community. So we felt that was a fitting story for this community. And of course, some stuff over in New Zealand, some canoe knuckles made out of wood. And of course the thing, how we present our culture out front, how they think we present our culture, but it's a very delicate thing, but we present our culture to protect the things that cannot speak for themselves. And then when you open it, a little salmon smolt is in your hand so that, you know, this is what you're protecting. You're using your culture for, right? Is to protect those things. Another piece down there, was a piece for the National Arboretum. They have a lot of exotic trees over there, and some of those trees are from here. And so I felt it necessary to carve something from that tree, from those trees. So that's the piece over in New Zealand. And then the last one is at the Portland building. And it's another collaboration between myself, Natalie Ball from Klamath, and Toma Villa from Yakima. And then basically I did the foundation of that, which is all these dowels, or 4,104 dowels, to make basketry patterns, but then also represent the first religion in the Northwest, which was stick game, a gambling game, which all other religions and kinship ties and tradeways all kind of followed that. Then also gambling, right? But then my friend Toma painted also another foundation of that, which is the salmon on top of that. And we're still kind of waiting for Natalie to see what happens and see how she manipulates this. So I'm still kind of waiting and waiting for great things from her and whatnot. So, and then of course we're at the end. Waga Kiele, thank you for listening to me. Just want to say once again, say thank you to the Sitka Center, and then also the IPCA grant and Oregon Cultural Trust and RAC and all these foundations that have invested in us to tell our story, but also once again speak for the things that cannot speak for themselves. We cannot restore our arts if we cannot restore our environment, and I feel very strongly about that. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Shirod. We don't, when we organize the residency program, we just honor the schedules of the artists and scientists and interdisciplinary folks who are coming. We don't like pick and choose who should be with whom. So it's just so exciting to have this wonderful cohort with so many people who are exploring really the leading edges and intersections of the relationship between people and land and culture, social practice artists, environmental justice issues. It's just very invigorating to have you, each of you here and all of you here together. So thank you to Shirod, Erin, Christian, Thomas, and Shobha. Thanks. We had well over 60 people tuning in tonight. So thank you to the Sitka audience. And just so grateful for everyone's time and attention. And good night, everybody.